Good evening. I'm Dr. Marc Bessler, and I'm here with Dr. Abraham Krikhely. We're excited to have you join us for this first Zoom remote educational seminar, where we're going to teach you a little bit about bariatric surgery and take questions at the end. I want to tell you a little bit about us. This program, the weight loss surgery program at Columbia Presbyterian, is one of the oldest in the city. We're going on 25 years now. We were amongst the first to be doing minimally invasive, amongst the first to be doing robotic surgery, and Dr. Krikhely has taken that on. Our commitment is to your lifelong health. Weight loss for life is our motto, and that means weight loss to live longer, to live better, and also to keep it off for life. That's our goal, and we're here to support you through that. Obviously, this is a big decision. We want to talk about that and how to make the right decision. We're very fortunate to be at New York Presbyterian Hospital, which is top five hospital in the country and the number one hospital in the New York area, and wonderful care as well as commitment to patient outcomes and experience. With that, I think we're going to move on to getting this started. And we have a couple of housekeeping things. We're going to take questions and at any time during this presentation, feel free to enter your questions in so we can take a look at them and get to them at the end of the presentation, when you'll also be able to keep asking questions then. We're not going to stop the presentation to answer the questions, but at the end, we'll get to the ones that we've received. Want to go to the next slide. So in order to ask your questions, for those of you who are not too familiar with Zoom, there's a Q&A box on the bottom of the screen and a chat box that you can click on. If you click on chat, your identification will be associated with that question. If you want to keep it private, put your questions in through the Q&A box. At the end, when we're taking questions, you'll have the opportunity to turn your video on. Right now, nobody who's a participant in the meeting, and there are 15 of you so far, we're expecting over 50, but none of you can see each other. It'll only be Dr. Krikhely and myself. At the end, you'll have the option to turn on your video if you want to ask us questions and have us see you doing that. We're also going to have some polls where we're asking you for some information so we understand a little bit about the audience we're talking to and can tailor our discussion towards that.
Hello, everyone. I'm Abe Krikhely. I just wanted to take this opportunity to introduce myself and thank you all for making the time to come out and meet us. With that, I'll take this to cue the first question to learn a little bit more about you guys. Do you guys see the poll question up?
Yes, we do. Okay, perfect. So the nice thing about these polls is we'll get the results up really right away. I guess you can see them on the screen. Sounds like a mixed group out there, but half knowing something about this, some thinking they know a lot about it, and hopefully that's right. So thank you for sharing that information. Have these results been shared with the group? I think it is. All right, I think we have a little video next we want to share with you about obesity. One of the things that we recognize is that this is a disease, that not everybody sees it that way. And there's a little video we put together to help explain that, to help show you our beliefs about this disease. We don't have audio, Cree. Well, try again.
Have you worked hard to lose weight only to gain it back? Do you feel like it's your fault when this happens? That you're a failure and just don't have the willpower to succeed? Society judges obesity as a personal failing, but it's not. What most people don't realize is that obesity is a disease. Due to biological factors, losing weight when you're obese is not simply a matter of diet and exercise. Based on the hard lifestyles of our ancestors, our bodies are programmed to store and maintain energy in the form of fat when we feast, so we have energy reserves available for times of famine. When you lose a lot of weight, your body believes it is in danger and pushes you to regain the weight and replenish your energy stores. It does this by increasing hunger and food cravings, and by going into economy mode, or burning energy at a much lower rate. So you may be working hard to eat healthy and exercise, but find your hunger and cravings have increased. And for some reason, no matter how much you exercise, you can't keep the weight off. At Columbia University Irving Medical Center, we understand how difficult this struggle can be and offer a wide variety of treatments from medication to surgery for obesity. Weight loss surgery is proven to help keep weight off. It can help reduce hunger, make smaller meals more satisfying, and give you back some control over your weight. Through our Weight Loss for Life program, over the past 20 years, we have helped thousands of patients successfully lose and keep off their weight. Take control of your weight today and make an appointment with us or go online to learn more about our program.
Thanks, Krikhely. I think that pretty much summarizes the idea that this is not a choice, but a disease. There's no doubt the disease is impacted by choices you make. But some people can make those same choices and not suffer with this. And we'll talk a little bit more about that along the way. Want to go to the next poll question? So understanding that weight regain is almost inevitable, I would say, at least some of it. For most people, and understanding that you probably wouldn't be watching this if you had success losing weight and keeping it off. We figured we'd get a sense of who's out there. The amazing thing is that most people can lose weight, and that once you're 100 pounds or so overweight, almost everyone who loses weight regains it. I'd say over 95% of people who lose weight once they're 100 pounds or more overweight regain it. That proves that this is a disease. The willpower it takes to lose the weight just can't fight against your body's drive to put it back on. Amazingly enough, I think we're sharing these results. You can see that the group here has discussed gaining most of its weight back and some. I would say even in my experience, most patients, when they lose weight, gain back more than they've lost. And that has to do with the economy mode that your body goes into, burning less calories. And when you go back to eating the way you were before, sometimes the weight increases beyond where it started. So we're going to get into our presentation now, now that we understand something about our group here, and go through some slides that Dr. Krikhely and I are going to narrate for you and walk you through. And then at the end, we'll take some questions. We expect to be about 20 to 30 minutes of educational material as we go forward with this, and then take time as we need for your questions. So this is what we're going to be talking about. We talked a little bit about obesity and why it happens. It's epidemic in the United States. Why choose surgery? What the options for surgery are, and then a little bit about the process of how you'll get to having surgery along the way. Obesity has become epidemic in the United States. A few years ago, About a third of patients, adults in the United States were obese. We're up to about 40%. It's predicted if we keep going this way that this is going to be past 50%, where it'll almost be the norm to have this disease. Obviously, this isn't something that only happens because of genetics. Genetics haven't changed in the past 20, 30 years dramatically, but genetics plays a role, as we showed earlier. Some people will just stay thin. Even if they eat extra calories, they'll burn it off. And some people, patients who become obese, are holding on to all those extra calories, and their body doesn't want to let it go. Those genetics lead to changes in metabolism, but behavior, food choices, exercising, the ability to get up and move around, which has been restricted obviously recently, all play a role in this. And so there are decisions you can make to help manage the disease, just like a diabetic shouldn't have sugar, and people with, you know, gluten sensitivity stay away from gluten. There are things, especially carbohydrates, that we think you need to stay away from. And obesity also causes a reduction in life expectancy significantly. For patients, the more overweight you are, the more years of life you lose along the way. And that's really important to understand, because the risk of the operations we're talking about, while not zero, are way, way lower than the risk of the disease we're going to be treating. So these curves on the left show, on the top for men, on the bottom for women, the increase in risk of death from obesity. If you look in the middle of the graphs, I guess I can point to it here with my pointer. This is the normal weight range, 22 to 25. And mortality is set at 1. That's baseline mortality. As you go up towards heavier, you can see here that by the time you get to a BMI of 35, mortality is more than doubled, almost 3 times. And when you get to greater than 35, it becomes over 3 times mortality. That's for men. For women, not quite as dramatic. Again, in the normal weight category here, it's 1. And as you get up to a BMI of 35, it's double. And as you get to a BMI of 40, it becomes close to triple. And so men and women have shorter lives when they carry around significant amounts of excess weight. This shortening in lifespan comes from lots of reasons. There are a lot of medical problems. The ones that shorten lifespan in the US tend to be cardiovascular disease, so heart attacks, diabetes, which leads to that. And as well, cancers are increased. We'll talk a little bit more about that. So from a combination of liver disease, cancer, cardiovascular disease, mortality is significantly increased. But there's many quality of life issues along the way. The venous ulcers that people get in their legs, and the joint pains and back pains, the sleep apnea and difficulty breathing, and never mind the quality of life that comes from not being able to run around with your kids, sometimes being able to fit in a airplane seat, or having to get that extra extender on the seatbelt. The quality of life issues are pretty significant, and we shouldn't ignore those. Obesity has been associated with an increase of death from over a dozen cancers. You can see here on this list the organs that are involved. Not only is obesity associated with an increase in the cancer incidence, it's also associated with a delay in diagnosis and an increase in mortality on a stage-for-stage basis. So an average weight person who has pancreas cancer is less likely to die from that pancreas cancer than the same stage pancreas cancer in an overweight patient. Never mind that the overweight patient was more likely to get it in the first place and is probably discovered at a later stage. The same is true for many other of these cancers. And unfortunately, people say, well, when I have a problem, then I'll lose the weight and deal with it. Obviously, for cancer and also for cardiovascular disease, it's often too late by the time the diagnosis is made. So what are the treatments for obesity? Everybody says just eat less, diet. We've already shown in that early video that dieting ultimately doesn't work. You can lose weight by dieting, but your body's going to fight back against you. And that's why Garfield here says diet is die with a T. You know, you cannot fight your body's resistance to losing weight forever and ever. You're going to be pushed by your body to put it back on. Exercise is really important no matter what. We showed how the metabolism slows down with weight loss, and exercise is the only safe thing we know to increase your metabolic rate, to increase your metabolism, building muscle and exercising. And so there is no doubt that the way to lose weight is by calorie restriction with diet and exercise. But the diet is really torture ultimately, because your body's going to push you. It's going to make you hungry. It's going to make you want to eat. And fighting back against that is really, really difficult. And that's where surgery comes in, because they can help make dieting, actually not dieting, it just more easily being satisfied, being less hungry, and more easily satisfied with a small amount of food. Of course, there are habits that have to change. You know, candy, soda, juices, things that are high in calories, sugar, etc., have to be replaced with other healthy issues. Certainly, some people have addictive eating patterns, or eating their stress, have difficult social situations that lead them to turn to food, and we have to find healthier ways to deal with that stress, and we're here to help with that as well. There are medications and increasing numbers of them that can help with weight loss, but again, this is a lifelong disease. Those medications will have to be taken for life. None of them is effective as surgery yet, and some of them require injection, the more effective ones. The endoscopic interventions, those are temporary right now for the most part. They're less effective than surgery and don't last much more than a year or so. And then the surgery, which is what we're here to talk about.
So why surgery? So surgery, we wish it was a cure. It's not a cure, but it is the most effective treatment we have to treat obesity and the medical problems that come with obesity. And it's meant to work together with you living a healthy lifestyle with the right nutrition, exercise, and choices for you to become a healthier person. So bariatric surgery helps people suffering from severe obesity to live longer. There have been numerous studies that have been able to demonstrate this. This is a very classic one where they followed 8,000 people who had gastric bypass. This was about 15 years ago. They followed them for 7 years, and they compared them with another 8,000 people who had similar degrees of obesity and similar medical conditions, but they chose not to have bariatric surgery. And what they found was that those people who got gastric bypass, they had 40% less mortality than the population that didn't get bariatric surgery. And specifically, 59% less mortality from heart attacks, 92% less mortality from diabetes, and 60% less mortality due to cancers. And these similar results have been replicated in multiple other studies. Bariatric surgery, this is the most effective tool we have to help you achieve the most weight loss and then to be able to keep it off longer. We're going to go over the different surgeries and the range of excess weight loss. Ranges from about 50 to 75%, depending on which surgery we're talking about.
Abe, let me just put in there that the disease is not your weight. As you point out, the disease is your excess weight. Excess weight is that's above the upper limit of normal, which would be a BMI of 25. So we'll show a chart, but if you calculate for your height what a BMI of 25 would be, the excess weight is your weight above that weight for a BMI of 25. And that's where we're talking about between 50 and 75% weight loss of that excess weight, not of your starting weight. So I think that's important to understand.
And so many medical problems, they go away or get better with bariatric surgery. We previously saw that big list, and pretty much every organ, every body part had something wrong with it related to obesity. And many problems go away. And some of the key ones that tend to get better that we tend to focus on a lot is diabetes, high blood pressure, cholesterol, sleep apnea, heartburn, joint pains, fertility problems, and kidney disease, and risks of cancers. The impact on diabetes has been so great that when they had this international consensus where medical experts, not just surgeons, but medical doctors from numerous societies from all over the world, they gathered in London they reviewed all the data. And based on all the data, they decided that bariatric surgery was the recommended treatment for diabetics who had a BMI greater than 40, and also patients with lower BMIs between 35 and 40 when their sugar levels were not adequately controlled with medications. Now Dr. Bessler is going to explain who qualifies.
So, you know, along the way, people say, this is the easy way out. We're here to tell you this is not the easy way out. It's not out. This is a tool that you're going to use, and we'll talk about that maybe more along the way, but it's a tool to help you when really struggling against something that's very, very difficult to fight back against. So if you look at this chart has height along the left side of it and weight in pounds along the top of it. Don't worry if you're not on here, but most people will find themselves on this chart. So if you go up to your height, and I'm 5 foot, well, I used to be 11, but let's say 10, and I weigh about 190 pounds. So my BMI is 26. That's right in the middle of normal range. If we were to go up in weight, and if I became a weight of 220, 230 pounds, besides the fact that my wife would kill me, I'd be in the significantly overweight range. BMI 35 is considered severely overweight if it's associated with a medical problem, such as high blood pressure, diabetes, etc. So that's in the darker orange group. If you fall into the pink group, if I ever got to 280 pounds, my BMI would be 42, 41, and I would qualify for surgery even without medical problems because my degree of increased risk of death would be so great from being at that weight that it'd be way worth it to have the surgery to reduce that risk. So either BMI 35 or over with medical problems, and the medical problems that most insurance companies qualify are diabetes, sleep apnea, hypertension. I can't think of much else that they go along with. Some of them, severe joint disease will actually count as well. Unfortunately, we have to deal with insurance companies, and we'll talk about that a little bit more. Fortunately, in New York, almost all insurance companies do cover this without, as long as you meet the criteria, without too much difficulty. Abe, you're muted, so I'm going to grab this, unless you can.
Okay. So can you hear me now? Yes.
Yes.
So now I'm going to talk about the different surgical options. So there are four common ones that generally we talk about. The sleeve gastrectomy, the gastric bypass, the duodenal switch, and less commonly now the gastric band. We've come a long way from the way bariatric surgery was performed in the early days when they had open surgery. Now we have minimally invasive surgery. The tools have been refined over the decades. Now we have robotic surgery, and the technology just gets better and better. So these surgeries generally are very safe. All of these surgeries are done minimally invasive, laparoscopic or robotic, small cuts on the belly, and we work on a TV screen. The surgery takes anywhere from 1 to 2.5 hours, depending on which surgery we're talking about. And all of these surgeries have more or less the same kind of preparation leading up to the surgery, as well as similar sort of hospital stay, 1 or 2 night hospital stay, and similar recovery outside the hospital. Rule of thumb, we say about 2 to 4 weeks. That doesn't mean you're in bed in your pajamas all day. You're up and around and living life, but gradually transitioning back into your normal life. Now we're going to go into the different surgeries one by one.
Yeah, I would say that gastric banding was the most common operation for a while. It's now fallen a bit out of favor, but patients did go home the same day when they were having a band. Our sleeve patients generally are the most common operation right now, and those patients stay one night. And the gastric bypass and the duodenal switch being a little bit more complex surgery, it's generally 2 nights, although the healthier patients who are just doing great post-op and want to sometimes can go home on the first night after surgery. So sleeve gastrectomy, as I mentioned, is the most common operation being done in the United States these days for weight loss. You know, it's funny, before the sleeve operation came along, I would always hear patients say, "Doc, can't you just make my stomach smaller?" And we'd say, "Well, we can, but it doesn't work that well." And the reason for that was we were trying to make people's stomach smaller by cutting it this way. And along came, it was actually a modification of the duodenal switch operation, but along came a sleeve gastrectomy where we cut it this way. And what we learned was this part of the stomach here that we were leaving behind previously when trying to make people's stomach smaller makes a powerful hormone called ghrelin. Ghrelin's the most powerful hunger hormone that we know of. And by taking out this portion of the stomach here, it actually decreases hunger. The other thing is this part of the stomach that we leave behind is the least stretchy part of the stomach. This is the most stretchy part of the stomach. We take it out. That's the part of the stomach that relaxes and allows you to eat a bigger meal. But when we take it out, the pressure in the stomach builds up much more quickly. And so now you have less hunger and getting a sense of fullness from a much smaller amount of food. There's also hormonal effects downstream that we'll talk a little bit more about with the other two operations, but there are hormones that cause satiety or that cause you to feel satiated and full when they get stimulated and released. And those are increased a little bit after sleeve gastrectomy. So it works by reducing hunger, by making you feel fuller from a smaller meal, and by giving you that satiety sensation a little bit more rapidly than you would have gotten it before the surgery. And that's how your body fights against the hunger. That's how we help you fight your body's desire to put the food back on, because your body wants to make you hungry. It wants to make you chase certain types of foods, high calorie foods. And this helps you with the hunger piece. You have to make the decisions to stay away from the high calorie foods.
And the average weight loss with this operation is about 60 to 70% of extra weight.
Yeah. So somebody who's 100 pounds overweight, and that roughly correlates to a body mass index of 40. So if you're qualifying for surgery with a body mass index of 40, you're about 100 pounds overweight. And we see about 60 pounds weight loss in that group of patients. If your body mass index is 50, you're roughly 200 pounds overweight. And we'd see about 120 pounds weight loss. Again, some younger patients, some patients lose more, some patients lose less. Those are just average numbers, but pretty dramatic weight loss from these operations. Some people worry, am I going to lose too much weight? As we go to talk about these next couple operations, the more complex ones, I don't want to look like too skinny or like I'm sickly or whatever. I will say that with proper care, almost nobody loses too much weight with any of these operations. That usually represents a problem that can be addressed. And people should be healthier. And our patients don't look unhealthy. They look actually incredibly healthy, no matter which operation they've had, as long as we're taking care of the issues if they come up.
So while the sleeve may be the right option for most of our patients, about 60% of patients who get bariatric surgery in our practice, as well as the rest of the country, are getting the sleeve gastrectomy these days. The sleeve gastrectomy can, one of the issues is just some patients end up getting reflux after a sleeve gastrectomy. And so if you already have reflux, significant reflux prior to bariatric surgery, then oftentimes you're steered more towards this option, which tends to get rid of reflux, a gastric bypass. It also tends to be a little bit better for diabetes. Now, this is an operation that's been around since the 1960s and has passed the test of time and has stuck around as a very effective option. Surgery takes us about an hour and a half, 2 hours. Most patients spend one or two nights in the hospital, same recovery outside the hospital and similar weight loss to the sleeve, slightly a little bit more weight loss, is 65 to 70% excess weight loss with a bypass. You know, similar, if somebody is 100 pounds overweight, roughly 60 to 70 pound weight loss one can expect. Again, this is done through this very similar incisions to what we do with a sleeve gastrectomy. And in this operation, what's done is we divide the stomach into two portions, a small portion here, and then this bigger portion. And then we bring up a piece of intestine and connect it to the small stomach here, so that when you eat, the food goes from the esophagus directly into the small stomach and directly into the intestines, and it bypasses this portion of the stomach and some portion of the intestines. Now, this works with weight loss and helping with the diabetes in two ways. Number one, because the stomach is smaller, you can't eat as much. Number two, the change in the anatomy also leads to a change in hormones, some of which impact your hunger, and some of which also targets your diabetes a bit better. Also, because of by changing the direction of the anatomy, all of the acid from this bypassed stomach and now and the bile that's in the intestine over here, it's no longer coming up to the esophagus the way it was before. It's being directed further down into the intestines so that if somebody had reflux, that's how the reflux ends up getting better.
You know, I would say that in all the years I've been doing this, gastric bypass has passed the test of time, as Abe said, but nobody likes the idea of having their intestines rerouted. The reason to go for a more complex operation like this is a patient who has bad reflux, because this operation will get rid of reflux, and patients with significant diabetes, because a gastric bypass is twice as effective as a sleeve at getting rid of diabetes, putting it into remission, literally having normal sugars off medications in up to 90% of patients, depending how severe the diabetes is. And we talk about that on an individual basis, the prediction. The worse the diabetes, the more aggressive the operation maybe needs to get rid of it. You might only have a 30% chance of getting rid of diabetes with a sleeve and a 75% chance of getting rid of it with a bypass. The second thing is people think I'm not going to be able to eat. I'm going to have diarrhea. And we really don't see that. People can eat most foods. Obviously, we encourage you to stay away from sweets, and that can lead to some side effects. But you can eat most foods. There's not diarrhea. And there's very little in the way of significant problems that comes from this rearrangement, other than some difficulty absorbing certain vitamins and minerals, which can be easily replaced by pills.
And so, you know, the picture may look more complex than the other one, and it is. The other one's certainly simpler, but in the terms of safety, they're both very safe. And for the most part, in terms of the main risks, I would say it has similar risks to that of the sleeve.
Yeah, I would say too that having either of these operations is less risk than having a knee replacement. It's less risk than having your gallbladder out for an infected gallbladder. And so these operations have become really, really safe compared to what they were 20 years ago when I started doing this, when the risks were 10 times higher than they are now. In large part because we're doing laparoscopy and small incisions, but also we've just gotten so much better at recognizing problems and taking care of them early. So this is the duodenal switch operation. You can see up here, a sleeve is performed. So a percentage of the stomach has been removed, leaving just a tube. And that tube tends to be very similar to the sleeve that we do when we're only doing a sleeve gastrectomy. So you have the weight loss based on that alone. And then we take the lower third of the intestine, about 300 centimeters, which represents what, about 10 feet, maybe not even, of the lower part of the small intestine is brought up to the first part of the small intestine right here, just beyond the stomach. And so all this intestine gets bypassed and you're only using the lower third of your intestine. So in addition to the sleeve, by bypassing two thirds of the intestine, most patients are losing weight and having their diabetes controlled by two mechanisms. All the mechanisms that you had from the sleeve and now the mechanisms that you had from the bypass by putting food into the intestine more quickly and those satiety hormones being released. This is the most effective weight loss operation we have, with over 70% weight loss being maintained. It's probably the operation with the least weight regain over time because it's the most powerful operation we have, being both a sleeve and a bypass. And this is the best resolution of diabetes that we have. So if somebody has severe diabetes, if somebody has the most weight to lose that they need to lose, someone who's, you know, maybe 350, 450, 550 pounds, sometimes we'll encourage an operation that's a little bit more aggressive to help you get closer to the healthy weight you want. And sometimes we'll do this operation in stages. For the heavier, sicker patients, we'll do a sleeve first, drop a bunch of weight, and if you still need more or the diabetes hasn't gone away, we come back and do this part of the operation by just moving some intestine up to the higher part of the intestine itself. This operation has also stood the test of time. A duodenal switch has been around since the 80s. It's a little bit more complex operation than even a gastric bypass, but the overall risk is not that much higher, and the benefits are significantly better for some patients than the previous two operations. There are many centers that don't offer duodenal switch because it's a more complex operation, number one, and because caring for patients afterwards, a little bit more complex number two. And so this needs to be an individualized decision, but we're very comfortable here and we've been doing this operation for over 20 years.
And every time, you know, when I see this operation, I think of some of the successes that we've had. I just remember this gentleman who had, he was in his 50s, he had horrible diabetes, losing his eyes, losing his kidneys, on multiple medications, on injectables, and he was heading toward dialysis. We did this operation, and a year later, when I saw him, he was off all insulin, his diabetes was totally under control, his eyes were better, his kidneys were better, and it just reinforces for me why it is that we're offering something like this for the patients that need it.
Weight loss for life.
And this is the gastric band. So Marc mentioned before how this was a popular operation many years ago, about 15 years ago. And over the last 10 years or so, it started to kind of fade away out of favor, largely because of the emergence of other options that were also effective, like the emergence of the sleeve gastrectomy, which is another simple option that works. Ultimately, one of the reasons it faded away is because the sleeve works better, you know, but this is still a good option that worked for many patients that has good results with weight loss, just not results as good as the other options. That might still be a good option for certain patients who, let's say, would benefit from bariatric surgery, but are afraid of having permanent change to their anatomy from stapled operations. Because this is the only operation that is removable, undoable. And it also happens to be the only operation that's adjustable. With this operation, basically what's done is a plastic band is placed around the top of the stomach, creating a squeeze, kind of like a belt. And what that accomplishes is it limits how much a patient's able to eat, and also helps patients from getting hungrier too quickly or too often. What's adjustable about it is the inner lining of the plastic is a balloon that could be made tighter or looser by adding or removing fluid. And that's done through this port that sits under the skin that needs to be accessed by the needle. That one of us or one of our nurse practitioners or other members of the team are able to access and adjust. So the weight loss results for this operation is about, let's say, 50% of extra weight. Those patients who have done well with this swear by it, but it has less weight loss than the other options. For it to work, patients need to get needle adjustments periodically, especially in the beginning, monthly for the first few months until you reach a point where it's just the right tightness of the band. And then periodically through the years, as you find yourself getting hungrier or having difficulty eating. So it's a higher maintenance sort of thing. Also, the plastic band itself and the tubing, sometimes you can have minor problems with the device itself that then leads to needing a removal of the device. And also a third of patients won't be able to achieve the weight loss results that they need to help achieve their goals. But yeah,
I would say that 50% is probably a rosy picture, and more like 30% of your excess weight loss if you take all comers, because we know that at 10 years, about a third of their patients have had their band out. So I look at this as not a permanent fix, but something that you can, you know, kick the can down the road for 8 to 10 years, perhaps, by losing some weight, keeping that under control. But I think most patients are ultimately going to have trouble or gain their weight back from this operation. So that's pretty much why I think it fell out of favor, is the long-term problems. Maybe the safest up front, but the highest rate of reoperation. Over 30% of patients ultimately need a reoperation, right?
So to summarize with the different options, it seems like for most patients, the sleeve gastrectomy seems to be the right option. For those patients who have bad reflux, they get steered towards the gastric bypass. Those patients who need more weight loss than the sleeve would offer, who have very bad diabetes, oftentimes gets steered towards the duodenal switch. And the band is often reserved for those patients who are not amenable to the other options, but still would benefit from bariatric surgery to help them fight obesity.
I would say that the band is become less than 10%, probably even smaller than that of our practice, maybe less than 5% of our practice.
Sure.
It still has a place for patients who want weight loss that maybe don't qualify for a weight loss operation. Self-pay for this, it's because it's outpatient, it's a lot cheaper than the other operations. And for certain very high risk patients, perhaps that the other operations might be a little too high risk for if they have really, really bad heart disease, things like that. So anyway, I think that the options are here and will help you when we meet you individually, figure out which is the right one. The process here for getting to surgery, first decide that it's something you want to explore. You don't have to decide you definitely want to do it. We're happy to talk to you about all the options and educate you. That's what we're starting with tonight. But that goes on as you meet us in the office. So education and consultation with our team. When we'll also talk about the workup that needs to happen and the evaluation we need to do of you to understand your health and pick the right operation. And then to help you meet your insurance requirements. Unfortunately, right now, we still have to deal with some insurance companies requiring 6 months of efforts to try and lose weight that's documented by your medical doctor for six consecutive months within the year before surgery. Nobody comes to us who hasn't tried this before. So I think it's a bit unfair, but that's what we face with some of the, especially managed Medicaid programs. I think they all require that right now. While UnitedHealthcare, Oxford, Cigna, and HIP no longer require 6 months, and Aetna only requires 12 weeks. So those insurances, it's a little faster process, but still a careful medical workup, careful education. You'll meet with our nutritionist. A psychosocial evaluation is required for everyone. And we do require in the weeks before surgery that you lose some weight because it makes the operation a little safer, a little easier. And you hit the ground running that way with, we believe, less risk of the surgery and being in better shape to deal with anything that comes up along the way. I guess the next step after this, and we'll talk about it, is just reach out to us. We're doing, you know, visits via video. We're doing visits in person. You'll get there. You know, those pictures that you saw a second ago represent, there are patients. They're not like, you know, at the bottom of what you see with some of these ads, with these results are not typical. These are pretty typical results. It's what we see. Not everybody becomes super skinny depending where they start. And we don't want people to be, you know, super skinny. We told you, you lose, you know, between 60 and 80% of your excess weight, which means you're going to carry about 20 to 30% excess weight still after these operations, but puts you in a much healthier and much better place with improved survival. We didn't show a slide, but we have one that shows that the more of your excess weight that you lose, the more of the lost years you get back. If you lose 80% of your extra weight, you get back 80% of those 9 to 12 years you would have lost. And so the degree of weight loss is really important and valuable here. Of course, the more you want to lose, the more complex the operation usually is. But if you work hard at it with the good food choices, exercise, and control of portion size, because you can get satisfied from much smaller amounts after these operations, it's how they work. I don't know if we put up the slide here that says this is a tool, but these operations are tools. I often say to patients, we're giving you a hammer, but if you don't bring nails and wood, we're not going to be building anything together. And the nails and wood is the exercise and the careful food choices. And we're here to help you do those things. So the next step, give us a call, email us, make an appointment. We'll see you in person. We've all been vaccinated, so pretty safe coming here to see us. And things are obviously cleared along the way, but also a video visit, which is not only in COVID times, but in general, more convenient. Don't have to deal with parking. Don't have to deal with, you know, as much time off of work or away from home. So video visits can definitely be a way to get the process started.
So
I say, I've been doing this for 25 years. Abe's probably been doing it for close to 10, and he's just terrific. No matter which of our hands you're in, you're in really good hands. Abe's a terrific surgeon and a wonderful doctor and a really nice guy to boot. I wish I could say the same for me.
So there's some questions over here. I'll read them out and then we'll answer them. So it says, I'm considering weight loss surgery. My only health issue is joint pain, sleep apnea, and sciatica. Is one surgery better than the other, sleeve or gastric bypass?
I'll take that one. So if there's no acid reflux or no significant acid reflux, and there's no diabetes in your history, generally you're going to choose a sleeve. Sleeve can lead to reflux, even in patients who don't have it, but most of the time it's manageable. So in patients who don't already have bad reflux or don't already have diabetes, usually the weight loss from sleeve, which is 60 to 65%, is enough to improve joint pain, sleep apnea, et cetera, back pain, sciatica. And without getting into, you know, your personal health more in detail, I would say that's a sleeve.
And I 100% agree. And ultimately, I just highlight, you know, every battle is won before it's ever fought. And we, for this reason, we try to optimize everyone prior to the surgery, and we review everybody's medical history in detail. And there's a workup that's done. And sometimes, you know, the workup may help guide the what option is right one way or another. But just based on that clinical information, I would agree that sleeve is what I would be recommending.
The next one is you quote numbers, or we quoted numbers of 60 to 70% weight loss. Why wouldn't a patient be able to lose a greater percentage of their excess weight? And I think that's a good question. I think, first of all, I'm not saying that you can't. Those 60 to 70% is an average. Some patients do lose more, but some patients also lose less. Remember back to the beginning little video we showed you, your metabolism will slow down as you eat less. And that less calories, say it's 800 to 1,000 calories, will help you lose a lot of weight. Over time, you'll eat between 1,000 and 1,200 calories, and your body's metabolism will come down to 1,000 to 1,200 calories. And that's where your weight loss stops and stays stable. Now, I tell all patients, carbs make you hungry after these operations, so stay away from carbs. You can stretch out your operation if you eat too much at one time, so keep your meal size small. 6 ounces is what we're aiming for. And regular exercise to keep your metabolism up. And people who do all those things probably do a little bit better. For sure, people who don't do those things regain weight back over time. So eating carbs, eating as much as you can at each time you sit down rather than a bunch of smaller meals during the day, and not exercising. I see a question here, can you regain the weight? Will lead to weight regain. It just will. Those things are the wood and the nails. You've got to bring them to the table if you want to build something. Without making good food choices, without getting help and support to make those good food choices, if you can't easily on your own, without the exercise, the operation is going to cause a bunch of weight loss, and a lot of it will be gained back. Most patients don't gain all their weight back because the operation still have some effect, even if you're not doing the right things. But to maintain it, that's the work for the rest of your life. Just the operations make that work easy. I would say makes it possible. It's almost impossible without it. I'll grab the next one, Abe.
And so, there's a question asking, I can have a consultation with you even if my primary care does not work at your hospital network. Yes, we work with many primary cares who doesn't work in our hospital networks. And we see patients from you know, the entire all of New York City, the boroughs, Long Island, Westchester, New Jersey. And I think that, you know, now with Zoom and telemedicine, I think we're able to take care of patients at farther distances through video visits. You know, for the surgery and for certain other times, it would be necessary to come to the hospital.
Yeah, I would say that we are a specialty hospital. We're one of the top hospitals in the country and certainly the top rated in the New York region. You should come here, even if your doctor's not here, because this is where you'll get the best care. And your doctor can help follow up, but we're always here if there's problems that develop. And when, you know, people say, well, why can't I go to a hospital near my house that's doing this type of surgery? And what I always say is you want to be at the place that you need to be if something doesn't go well. If everything goes well, you could probably have this operation at home, right? But But if things aren't going well, that's where you need to be in the best place you can be. And oftentimes it's too late if you're not in that place when the problem happens. So the next question is a BMI of 34.9. Let's make that 35 because nobody's as tall as they think they are. Let's face it. After high school, we all start shrinking. I was 5'11 at one point. So let's say it's a BMI of 35 and the only health issue is chronic asthma. Asthma, unfortunately, is not one of the medical problems that the insurance companies count as a serious obesity-related medical problem. Now, I would say that serious asthma would qualify, in my opinion, as a significant medical problem that can be helped by weight loss. We know that asthma improves after significant weight loss. And if I were to do an operation for somebody, let's say they came in, they say, I have the $35,000 or whatever dollars it's going to take to get this done, and I want to pay for it. I might try and still talk you out of it, but because there's, you know, issues about self-paying for things, but somebody who wouldn't be greatly impacted by that, say, and we were going to do surgery, I'd probably pick a gastric bypass for an asthma patient. And my reasoning for that would be that reflux can be seriously either aggravated or can be induced by a sleeve. And asthma is often triggered by reflux. Now, it doesn't mean you can't have a sleeve if you have asthma. It's just that if your main goal was to get rid of your asthma, I think a bypass has a better shot of doing that. There's not clear data to support what I'm saying, but that's what I would probably recommend. A patient who wanted a sleeve could have a sleeve, recognizing that if they got reflux, it might actually aggravate the asthma. But as it stands, a BMI of 35, but with asthma, probably wouldn't qualify. We would work you up for unrecognized diabetes, unrecognized sleep apnea, talk to you about your joint issues, because oftentimes we can find other medical problems that you're not even yet aware of, especially sleep apnea or early forms of diabetes. So we would certainly look into that. And any patient with a BMI of 35 or over, we'll see in the office and try and figure out how to get you coverage for it.
So we have another question here. Is it safe to have children after the sleeve? Yes. There are many patients who have obesity who suffer from polycystic ovaries and they're having a hard time getting pregnant and obesity impacts fertility. And oftentimes the bariatric surgery itself helps improve that and they improve their fertility as well. We recommend that you don't get pregnant for at least 18 months after the surgery, where this period of time you're more sensitive to have nutritional deficiencies, vitamin deficiencies, and want to make sure that everything's okay. But after that, it's totally safe to have children. And it's also obviously important to work with us and with your OB to make sure that your vitamin levels are okay and everything's okay through your pregnancy.
Yeah, there's several studies that show that outcomes of pregnancy are better after weight loss surgery because overweight patients tend to get diabetes during pregnancy and to have more obstetric complications. So outcomes of pregnancy after weight loss actually seem to be better. And there's now one study that shows that children born to mothers after they've had weight loss surgery are less likely to become obese themselves than children born to the same mother who didn't have weight loss surgery. And so there's something about not having the obesity around while the baby's growing inside you that I guess doesn't signal that obesity is the norm in some ways. And so it's a pretty amazing positive impact on childbirth. And raising a child, I guess. Successful liver transplant 8 years ago with multiple hernias and excess weight gain. Hernias happen commonly in obese patients and especially after the large incisions that come from transplant. Doctors at Montefiore Transplant Center recommended you come to us. Well, that's a nice compliment because they do have a program at Montefiore and they do liver transplant there, but the expertise really in taking care of this complex stuff is best here. A BMI of 42, certainly we would qualify you for weight loss surgery. We've done liver transplant patients. We've done patients with sick livers before transplant and after transplant as well. It can be complex surgery because there's a lot of scarring sometimes from a liver transplant. It's a very big operation. But we've almost always been able to get it done. A few times I've actually done it after other surgeons have said they couldn't. So certainly we can take care of that for you. We usually recommend the hernias be addressed after the weight loss because they're less likely to come back and less likely to have complications. So look forward to seeing you because that'll be a challenging day.
So there's another question. What do you offer as far as aftercare support, access to dietitian, follow-up with a surgeon? So I would say that the bariatric, I guess, yes to all of those questions. And, you know, the bariatric surgeries, once you get there, that's not the end of the process. I call it the beginning of the process, the beginning of that journey, you know, and it's important to recognize that you're part of our team and we're a part of your team. You're the captain of that ship, and we will help guide you through and help you achieve your goals and make sure that you're safe and healthy and you have no issues along the way. And that if you do have issues, that we help you through those issues along the way. After the surgery, you definitely meet with us, the surgeons, and you meet with us and our team periodically, more frequently in the first year and then less frequently in the subsequent years. Then you meet with us 2 weeks, 6 weeks, 3 months, 6 months, and a year after the surgery, and then 2 years, and then annually after that. We do have support groups that are run by our dietitian as well as our nurse practitioners that I think they meet monthly. Is that right?
Yes.
They meet monthly.
And, you know, now with Zoom, we may be able to do that even more frequently because the issue is really getting people to come onto site has been sometimes difficult. The other thing to know that's important is, you know, surgeons are often in the operating room, but we have two nurse practitioners here. They're wonderful. One of them, Gio, has been with me for over 20 years, and they're here in the office all the time. And so you have expert-focused bariatric, you know, medical care all the time available here. So we'll see you anytime there's a problem. We want you coming. A little bit of weight gain, we want to see you. A little bit of pain somewhere, we want to hear about it. Because we're the experts and we're committed to you for life. You know, it's weight loss for life for you, and we're here for you for that journey. There's a question in the chat box. I had a gastric bypass in 2009. I have gained back almost all the weight. Sorry to hear that, and also glad it's almost. I'm also anemic and feel weak. The only way I absorb iron is through IVs. Is there a way to reverse this? So firstly, gastric bypass is actually a reversible operation. We hate to have to reverse it, but sometimes we do. As far as the weight loss goes, we can revise gastric bypass. We can convert them. We can refresh them and certainly make the gastric bypass more effective again. But my guess is gaining most of the weight back comes from behavioral issues. Like I said, eating carbs, large meal sizes, and not exercising. So I would work to help you reverse those behaviors and then consider an operation if you wanted to help you lose more weight and get back to where you were. As far as the iron goes, people can absorb iron, but oftentimes not enough by just taking it once a day. So sometimes taking it 2 to 3 times a day is necessary to absorb iron by mouth. Menstruating women losing iron every month often do need intravenous iron therapy until they stop menstruating, and then it usually is manageable with oral medication. But getting far enough behind can make it very difficult to catch up. A yearly iron intravenous infusion during childbearing years is sometimes necessary. I'd say in about 15 to 20% of patients. A third of patients will become iron deficient, but I think half of those patients aren't taking their supplements well or properly. And the other half just can't absorb enough orally and do need intravenous supplementation. The intravenous iron is not a big deal. It takes it an hour or so in the infusion center and done. So obviously this is a more complex conversation, but to someone's earlier question, without the right behaviors, the weight can come back. It doesn't usually, if you're doing the right thing. About 15 to 20% of patients who've had a gastric bypass will regain back half their weight or more, 15 to 20%. That means 80 to 85% are keeping off half or more of what they've lost. Abe, can you see the other questions in the chat box?
Yes. So question that says, if I am at least 100 pounds overweight, how much weight would I have to lose before surgery? We don't have a required set in stone number that you have to lose in order to qualify for the surgery. But if we can lose 5 to 10% of our body weight in the weeks leading up to surgery with being on a liquid diet, it would certainly make the surgery easier, help prepare your body to withstand the stress of surgery and anesthesia, as well as sometimes decrease the size of the liver so that it's out of the way when we're doing the surgery. We feel like it definitely makes the surgery a bit easier, but we don't have a set in stone number that you need to lose. Now, sometimes when patients have much higher BMIs, or let's say if they're, let's say, like 200 pounds overweight, or if a lot of their weight is concentrated in their belly rather than the thighs, then in those scenarios, we may do a liquid diet a bit longer to actually try to lose a bit more weight, where we think that the impact on your body and your physiology may be more substantial.
We do a liquid diet for 2 weeks before surgery. Not everybody manages to get it done. But I know when patients are following the liquid diet well, because they lose about a pound a day. So 2 weeks is about 14 pounds. Somebody who doesn't lose 10 to 15 pounds, you know, in the 2 weeks before surgery probably hasn't stuck with that liquid diet. That liquid diet is 800 calories a day. Can't lose much more than a pound a day, no matter what, I would say. But somebody who comes in and they've lost 5 pounds, we still go ahead with surgery. It's not about having to meet some artificial goal. I know there's, you know, the TV show out there, My 600 Pound Life, where the doctors make patients lose an incredible amount of weight. I think showing a commitment to making change is an important part of this. And that's one of the things we'll evaluate and talk about in the office. This is not an easy way out, and it's not a quick fix. It's something you got to work along with. But I don't think taking somebody who's having struggling to lose weight, has been working their whole life to lose weight, and putting a specific number they have to reach is really a fair or appropriate thing to do. Losing some weight sometimes to get you in a better shape to have surgery when you're high risk because of the medical problems that the weight has brought on can certainly be an important goal. And then we might go for more weight loss before surgery. I see another question about age cutoff. There is not an absolute age cutoff. I've operated on an 80-year-old with severe diabetes. So 71 is certainly not at the highest end. What we do say is it's not entirely clear that the longevity benefits accrue to older patients. I mean, obviously a 70-year-old is closer to the latter stages of life than a 30-year-old. So it's hard to give you back those years as much. But if you have diabetes, if you have significant other disease that we can improve, not only will we add potentially some years, but dramatically improve quality of life. And I think for those reasons, we take on patients in their later years as well. So there's not an absolute age cutoff, but it's an individual decision that needs to be made along the way. So no, there's not a cutoff. 71 years old is not a problem, even without severe diabetes, et cetera. It depends on an individual evaluation of your current medical condition, et cetera. Really everything we do in medicine, but especially this, is a risk-benefit analysis. We want to make sure that what we're doing is overall on average going to help significantly and not hurt. So we evaluate the risk of the individual person against the benefits that we hope for them to achieve. And we want to see the benefits significantly outweigh the risks before we proceed with something. And that's our general attitude and take on this. I think that's it with the questions. I believe that you can turn your video on if you want to come face to face with us. You don't have to. Certainly your name will come up if you do. And so it won't be, you know, as private. But if you want to take a few more minutes, if anybody has any other questions, there's still 16 of you out there. We're happy to answer them. Otherwise, it's been great talking to you all, and we hope you got a lot out of this. I think we had one more poll question. Did we? We might not have. We should. There you go. So after hearing all this, we have two questions. Your main objective in your weight loss journey, is it to obtain your maximum weight loss, as much weight as you possibly can, to select an option with the least surgical risk, which might have less weight loss, to obtain optimum health, or to find the best balance of the two? And then where are you in your weight loss journey? Are you just beginning? Are you ready to go? Are you looking for the right program? That'll help us understand who's out there as well. So those results being shared, nobody focused on the maximum weight loss, which is kind of interesting. And generally what we see, people want to be the healthiest and to have a nice balance between risk and achieving good weight loss. So two thirds, well, I guess only three people answered this question, to obtain optimum health. I think quality of life is a big part of that. And obviously keeping risk down. And an equal spread, right? How do we have one of three? I guess one person chose not to answer, but just beginning to explore my options and one person ready for surgery. So no matter where you are in your journey, considering if surgery is right for me. No matter where you are in your journey, we're here to help. The one-on-one consultation, we're not here to say you have to be ready for surgery when you come to see us. We want to help you make the right decision for yourself. So we're really glad you joined us. The next steps, call for an appointment either in person or via video. Our website, I think you can put that up now, Cree, obesitymd.org. And there's other URLs as well, where we have a lot of information about these operations as well. And you can reach out to us through that mechanism as well, because we have a sign up request for appointment on the website. We actually also have a BMI calculator on the website, so you can punch in your height and weight and it will come up with your BMI, so you don't have to find a chart. Those are available online as well. So Cree's email is up there directly. You can reach out to her. We'd love to know that you saw this program when you call. So if you do call for an appointment, please let us know that you saw this Q&A, this informational session online. That'll help us know how valuable it is to you guys. And there's our phone number and one of our URLs. Thanks for joining. Abe and I are really happy to be doing this, and we hope to do it again. So tell folks that they should look out for it, because we hope this is a valuable education and introduction for you. Have a good night.